Hey, says here, anthropologists found an episode of the Lawrence Welk Show dating back to 1 million BC.
Ooh! Maybe it's one we haven't seen yet.
One of the earliest and most enduring of the television variety series, The Lawrence Welk Show brought musical entertainment and homespun hijinks to the American public every Saturday night for 27 years. The stories behind the bubble machine on Lawrence Welk's TV Treasures.
One, two, and...
One thing people don't recognize is that when my father went on national television, he was 52 years old. And many people think, well, geez, Lawrence made it early in life. No, he didn't. He made it at 52. And he was 79 years old the last year we did a television show. The story of my dad's life is truly a fascinating one. He was raised in Strasburg, North Dakota, and in 1924, he left the farm to go out and pursue his career. He was 21 years old, and he spoke no English. He went from being an amateur accordion player to having his own band all within the span of 5 years, five short years. His first band was called the Hotsy Totsy Boys. And then came the Honolulu Fruit Gum Orchestra. And he got to be known all through the Midwest because he played barn dances and one-nighters all over. By the late 1930s, he had become pretty well known. People knew who Lawrence Welk was, and he played most of the major hotels in and around the Chicago area. He even did some soundies and actually a couple Hollywood short films. And I think he thought that was going to be his claim to fame and this is what would break him. But it didn't. Nothing really happened. And then in 1951, he came out to California and he played at the Aragon Ballroom, and KTLA, the local channel in Los Angeles, televised him for 4 years. Finally, on July 2nd, 1955, he went on national television as a summer replacement show. And the rest is history.
One, two, and...
Myron was the world's greatest accordionist. I mean, he was so great that he didn't even have to look down at his keyboard when he would play. He was Lawrence Welk's right-hand man. I mean, he really took charge of the band on the road, and he was the assistant director. Lawrence Welk really did rely on him a lot. And he was so easygoing. I mean, nothing upset Myron, and everybody loved him.
The television show, when it first went on the air, was very simple. It was pretty much the way he was a band when he was out on the road. They had an orchestra. My dad had a boy singer. He had a girl singer, a champagne lady. And the rest of the singers basically came out of the band.
Love me or leave me and let me be lonely. I want you only and I love you only. I'd rather be lonely than happy with somebody else.
He liked to have multi-talented people. I mean, if you sang and played, that was great. But if you did anything else, it was better.
But I love girls.
Rocky was one of the most popular performers he ever had. In fact, to this day, people come up to me and want to know where Rocky is.
Whenever I see girls for me, they always put a show on. I love their lovely hair and eyes and nose and lips and so on.
But the people fell in love with this guy's face.
When my lips meet another pair, 'cause I love girls.
Lawrence made the statement, you never know what Rocky's going to do when the red light goes on. I thought it's a heck of a compliment.
By the sea, by the sea, by the beautiful sea, you and I, you and I.
Alice Long, she was something.
When each wave comes around.
We did quite a few things together. Most of the time, they were comedies or in a skit. She was part of the band. She was one of the guys, Alice Long was. I love her.
I love to be beside your side, beside the sea, beside the seaside, by the beautiful sea.
When we first started on the show, Alice Long was a champagne lady, and Dick Dale was a featured singer, but he also played in the band. There were several of those players in the band who were actors or singers who Mr. Welk really put on the screen a lot because they were so terrific.
Up, up, a little bit higher.
Oh, my, the moon is on fire.
Come, Josephine, and my flying machine going up, all on goodbye.
When I was 15 years old and in high school over at St. Monica's High School, one of my classmates was Diane Lennon. We called her Dee Dee. I didn't know she sang at all. And so one night I asked her out. And she said, well, I can go, but I have to be at the Elks Club at 10 p.m. I'm singing with my sisters. So I, well, we can be there.
There's much more.
So I hear these four little girls singing a cappella, and I'm going like, wow, these kids are great. So when I got home, I told my dad, I said, Dad, you won't believe these girls I just heard. So he told me, yeah, oh, I'm sure they're great. You know, one of these days we'll have to hear them. And it was like, okay, you know, move along.
And Sunday morning, we were all at church and came back and had a phone call from Larry. And he said, get over here. Dad's sick in bed with a cold. I want him to hear you sing. So we went over, and sure enough, Mr. Welk got out of bed in his smoking jacket, which we had never seen before.
The velvet smoking jacket, yes, and slippers, and oh. He said, my son said you can sing, so sing for me.
He can turn the tide and calm the angry sea.
And he said, well, you can sing. And he picked up the phone and he called his musical director, who was George Cates. And we sang over the phone to George. And Mr. Welk said, well, I want you to be on my Christmas Eve show this year. And we were on just about every Saturday night for 13 years after that.
So Larry,
all because of Larry,
discovered us.
Haven't you gone to bed yet, Janet?
I was just going to, Daddy.
Did you say your prayers?
Yes, I did.
Well, come on then. Off
they weren't just singers. I mean, they sang, but it's what they sang.
One,
and the way they sang it.
Little one, yes, the world's really round.
This orchestra had all these musicians that could come down in front and perform. For instance, Aladdin, who was a violin player, had been with Xavier Cugat for years. He could sing, and he was a great actor.
So that you'll see the bluebird if it should come near.
Aladdin was one of our favorites because he was just a ham wadam that would do anything, and we just adored him. He reminded us of our grandpa. Aladdin really guided us along the way. He helped us so much with our showmanship. He was just determined to get us, you know, into showbiz. And
Bob Lito. Bob Lito would play the violin every week, but it was kind of a comedy type number, and it was so cute. You really looked forward to seeing what Bob would do every week.
You had Buddy Hayes, the bass player. He could do comedy. It just seemed like everybody in that show was just so unique.
And Jerry Burke played the organ every week, and that was a big thing. And Larry Hooper played the piano and sang with his low voice.
Oh, happy day, oh, lucky me.
He wasn't singing when I first came on, and he came up with a big hit, Oh, Happy Day, and then he was singing on every show. Great talent.
Oh, lucky.
Buddy Merrill had this baby face. He was very young when he joined the band, but he looked like the kid next door. Everything that Lawrence had in this show had the chemistry to be a success. The chemistry that the American people could understand and enjoy. They could relate to our music.
By the name of Big Tiny Little was playing the piano on the Lawrence Welk Show. He left, and I got a call from Lawrence Welk himself. He asked me if I'd like to come down the following week and be on a show. And I had answered the phone. He says, "This is Lawrence Welk," and he said, "Would you like to come down and be on the show next Saturday night?" I said, "Oh, I certainly would." So I went on the show, and he had me on a week-to-week thing. And then my 20th birthday came up, and he heard about it. And so he didn't tell me, but they had a birthday cake ready. I did my number on the TV, looked at the camera like I did on the other three or four or five shows, and he came out with this cake and hired me right on the air. How about that?
L'amour, toujours, l'amour. Love, now at last you found me.
Joe Feeney had real talent, big talent. We always talked about maybe someday we'd go to Vegas and have our own show or something. It was talk, of course. We never went. But he can sing high notes, low notes. He's always on pitch, right on. Didn't study. It just came out.
Jimmy Roberts was a Kentucky gentleman. He sang very well. Fortunately, our voices blended.
I had worked with Jimmy for forever. Been on the road with him, done the television show with him, gone through a lot of changes in our lives and everything. And this was years later, I'm sitting in the audience, and he comes out in his overcoat to do San Francisco.
In San Francisco.
And when he hit the stage, my heart jumped. And I said, "Oh, that's Jimmy Roberts." And it took me back to that time at my grandmother's when his face was so big on the screen and he was a big star and on television.
Your golden sun will shine for.
I got laryngitis. And Norma came in to help with the lead because I had no voice. And that's how we met Norma.
She was
Norma.
A studio singer, very, Norma very Zimmer. Excellent studio singer.
Yes.
I did some recordings for Lawrence Welk, the Calcutta and some of the oohs and ahs with our girls' quartet. And I did a little four-bar solo. And he said, "My, you have a pretty voice. Come and do that on the show."
Why do I love you? Why do you love me?
Why? Lawrence loved duets. He loved group singing. So we had, for the first few years, a duet almost every show.
We were so glad she became the champagne lady because she was one of us. She had the greatest sense of humor. She always had that little dignity when she'd dress and do her hair and everything, but she had this raucous laugh.
Yeah.
And when Norma would laugh, it made everybody laugh.
Her many times, dressing rooms down at the studio. She was such a fun roommate. Man, she would cackle like a hen all the time. We loved it.
That's the dance to do.
What is the yeah?
I've watched the Lawrence Welk Show for all the years that the girls were on, since 1955. And we had a family conference when Mr. Welk asked me to join the show. I said, "Boys, would you mind if I did the Lawrence Welk Show?" And they said, "Go ahead, Mom. None of our friends watch it anyway."
One of my dad's favorite types of music was Dixieland. And we shared that. We'd listen to old recordings of people like Bix Beiderbecke and Red Nichols and the Five Pennies. So I had heard a musician, Pete Fountain, on an old recording, and I loved him. And I saw he was going to be at the Shrine Auditorium. So I went backstage at intermission. I said, "My name's Lawrence Welk." And I never went by Lawrence Welk. I always went by Larry, but I wanted to make sure he got the connection. And he looked at me and he said, "Kid, if you're Lawrence Welk, I'm Abraham Lincoln." So we got talking, and then I went home and I started playing them records. It was just amazing. And of course, my dad, he was just thrilled when Pete became a regular cast member. I was down at the studio quite often. I was the band boy for years.
Junior, would you just come out for 1 minute, please?
I was just standing backstage. And my dad had worked this up with Pete, where they were going to call me out to direct the band, and I was just petrified.
But anyway, I thought as long as you're 18 years old now, it would be okay for you to come on the show. How about you leading the next number? As long as you discover Pete, go over there, this is his number, and direct it. Let him stomp it off, uh-huh. One and a two and a...
You can tell by looking at Pete, he was getting the biggest chuckle out of watching me.
Thank you.
Welk Show went on the air in 1955, and it was an instant success. After 52 years of hard work, Lawrence became an overnight sensation.
Lawrence Welk loved his orchestra. I mean, he loved to be in front of that orchestra. I've never seen anybody, it was just like somebody turned on a light inside him when he would get in front of that band.
Critics had a tendency to say, this is a corny show, it's bubbly music, or whatever, but as far as the musicianship, the best.
There were so many wonderful musicians. You know, they came from Glenn Miller Band, and they were great artists. They were just great show people.
We went off the air in 82, I mean, did our final show, and there's not a band in the country that was as good as his.
Lawrence always had the ability to keep bringing in better musicians and better musicians, because it was a job the musicians wanted.
The Lawrence Welk Show, it was very, very popular. I would go to the market and people would stop me and say, oh, the show was wonderful Saturday night. Do you have time for me to call my folks and come down to meet you?
And don't forget, Lawrence Welk!
That's what you watched on Saturday night. Just like Milton Berle was Tuesday night, and Lucy was Monday night, and Ed Sullivan was Sunday night. And Saturday night was the Lawrence Welk Show.
Lawrence Welk, how did he get in there?
During the commercial, Lawrence comes over to me, he says, now, remember, Jack, when you look out there at that camera, there's 20 million people watching you. I was just trying to make a living in show business, you know? I'm going to go all over the country with a marimba, kids in a house trailer. And the way it ends up, I'm on television every week, and I get to live in the same house every week. I tell you, the whole thing is an American dream to me. you know? It really is.
My father handled this musical family with an iron glove. No. My father handled the musical family like a family. And I think maybe that's why the name, so to speak. But he was like the father, there's no question. And I think he saw himself in that role. I think he wanted to make sure that his musicians, that their relationships were happy, that they behaved themselves.
Hi, I'm Bob Burgess from Long Beach, California. I'm 19 years old, and I'd like you to meet my partner, Miss Barbara Boylan.
Hi, I'm 19 years also, and we both go to Long Beach State College. And maybe some of you recognize Bobby. He was on the Mouseketeers for 3 years.
I want to tell you folks that you have a real treat coming right now. They're about ready to go into this special dance they worked up right to this recording.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, I was lucky. In my career, I went from one family institution to another. And one of the great quotes from Lawrence Welk is, I never had any trouble with Bobby because he was raised by Walt Disney.
We did know that people started to know us right away. And it was a big responsibility for us to live up to our image and to what people thought of us. And my dad always told us that you are going to meet many, many people in this career of yours, and you will leave them for better or for worse, and that is your choice.
The other day, I was over at the Lennon House for dinner, and afterwards, they had their regular song fest. I enjoyed it so very, very much, I asked the entire family to come down and be on this show. I think you will enjoy it, too.
On the 500th show, Lawrence Welk Show, it was what we call during the hootenanny days.
There is a meeting, there is a meeting here tonight, there is a meeting here tonight, there is a meeting here tonight, there is a
We had all 11 of us brothers and sisters sang one of our favorite hootenanny songs called There's a Meeting Here Tonight.
There's a meeting here tonight, I can tell by your friendly face, there's a meeting here tonight, oh.
I was 9 when I started and 23 when I left the show.
It's interesting, even today, when you go shopping or you go somewhere and people stop and say, oh, I grew up with you, and I liked to wear my hair like you, or I loved Janet, she was my favorite, and it's just
everybody
fun.
Had a favorite.
They all, yeah, and I think because we weren't glamorous, beautiful, shining stars, we were the little girls next door. Buddy Merrill was pretty young. I think he was only a year or two older than I was. And I had this crush on him. He was so cute with his curly hair and his big brown eyes. And he was very shy, and I was very shy. And he had a wonderful two-tone green Dodge convertible. And I used to say, oh, someday I'm going to go on a date with Buddy in that car.
Find a wheel and it goes round, round, round as it skims along with a happy sound as it goes along the ground, ground, ground till it leads you to the one you love. Come along and see the new Dodge Dodge. Never saw a car look so sleek and smart.
When my dad was on local television, one of his sponsors was the local Dodge dealers of Southern California. And to some degree, they were instrumental in getting Dodge to put them on in 1955 as a summer replacement show. It was sponsored by Dodge.
Take the wheel and let the fun begin. Let's go riding in a brand new Dodge.
Dodge, the car that says let's go, presents the music that says let's dance.
Every year, they would give my mom and my dad new Dodges to drive, and then they would turn them in, and they'd get new cars the next year. early on, every member of the band was given a Dodge to drive. But Dodge was clearly instrumental in getting Lawrence on television, and he never forgot that. He had a fierce loyalty to Dodge. And even after Dodge was no longer a sponsor, he just would never drive anything but a Dodge.
I started coming up with production ideas of my own. And Jim Hobson went to Lawrence and said, you know, Jack Immel's got pretty good ideas we got to listen to. So Lawrence said, well, why don't we have him come to the meetings and see what he's got to offer. After a few months, then I became associate producer, assistant to Jim Hobson.
Greetings, friends, and how do you do?
And then we went into color. Well, with color, that gives you more reason for production.
We'll have some pop candy and a toy balloon on a sunny Sunday afternoon. We'll hear that rinky-tinky wonderful sound and catch a ring around the merry-go-round. We'll have a happy day.
The minute the cameras were on and the girls were there and the boys were there, what you saw was color. To get all these beautiful pastel 1908 gowns with their big hats and all. And it really was a beautiful look. We did all these bright colored suits. I showed Lawrence the swatches, and they were orange, and they were powder blue, and there was green, and he said, do you think that that would be good for me and my audience? I said, Lawrence, they'll love you with it.
Anything goes. From Hollywood, it's the Lawrence Welk Easter Show.
They had just done My Fair Lady in the films, and I knew Western Costume made the costumes, and they still had them in lockup. And I pleaded with him. I said, I'll take such good care of them. Believe me, it will come back just like they went out. And I finally talked him into letting me use it. And it really was a sharp look. It was clean and pretty. And I think it made the girls feel so special in these costumes.
Doing a weekly show, you try to come up with songs and songs and songs. And if you could base your songs on a theme, now that opens a whole new ballgame, you see. So we started, like, holidays, for instance, you know, Christmas, of course. There's so many production numbers you can do about Christmas. Then we would go into Easter, and then you had the 4th of July. You could do the seasons. Spring, winter, fall, and you could do Academy Award songs.
Lawrence Welk was very meticulous in who he hired. He always felt that any reflection on any member of his musical family was a reflection on him. So he did a lot of homework, a lot of background on various people. I think he probably kicked over every garbage can in my neighborhood to get information, but that's part of the package. When you deal with 50-odd musicians and entertainers, you have to have a set of rules, so guidelines, and he was very strict in that area. You knew what he wanted, and you tried to stay within the guidelines.
There was never any hanky-panky. It was always just good, clean entertainment.
Sweet and low, sweet and low, how sweet that memory, how long ago, forever.
Nivens was very unique on our show. We all loved her. She had a great sense of humor, but she was so prim and proper all the time. She wore white gloves most of the time, and her hair had to be just so, and her makeup, and she walked very straight. She had perfect posture. I used to imitate her all the time. She had perfect posture. She played the flute just a certain way.
What a character.
Lawrence was a stickler for certain things. When you showed up at work, you had to be on time. You had to know your song. He was very fussy about if people gained weight, and he would come up to somebody and say, this tummy's getting a little big.
He knew what he wanted, and what he wanted was right. He was always right.
Those were the days, my friend, we thought they'd never end. We'd sing and dance forever and a day. We'd live the life we choose. We'd fight and never lose. For we were young and sure to have our way.
I never had seen the Lawrence Welk Show until Ron got on it. I mean, I know my parents and grandparents watched. I was never home on Saturday night. I mean, we were out running around. So I just didn't know much about it. And man, the first time I went back to my hometown of Tupelo, Mississippi, I found out how big it was. I mean, she was as big a star as Elvis in Tupelo.
So I said, we got to figure out a way to get you on this show, too. So I got Guy to bring his guitar down. And I said, Lawrence, we've got a song that we'd like to do. Can we sing it for you? Come on into my room, Girls and Boys, and you sing the song for me. And we sang Little Toy Trains for Lawrence. And of course, we did the Christmas show together. And it was very well received by the audience.
Little toy trains, little toy trains.
Yeah, you got a lot of mail. Never had a husband and wife team on the show, so that was it. We came back a couple more times to make sure it wasn't a fluke. We got all that mail. And then he hired me.
Close your eyes.
The attraction of Guy and Ronan to Lawrence Welk audiences is, I don't know, we've thought about it a lot. We know it had a lot to do with the fact that we were young, married couple, so much in love. They loved the way we looked at each other. And I always tell people, you know, a lot of that was we were looking at each other to see who remembered the words.
Little boy's toys.
But it was amazing to us, the popularity that we had and still do have around the country.
Don't you think it's time you were?
He had, I think, about 20 secretaries who read the fan mail. And Lawrence kept a record of everything that was requested, comments about the singers. He listened to his audience from the beginning.
When Lawrence hired me, I said, Lawrence, why are you hiring me? You got so many singers on the show now. He said, well, I don't have anyone like you. Little did he know, so he was hiring people, and it was a very unusual and a wonderful feeling. Because you were, they talk about the musical family, and they really were. We had a lot of friends.
I've been crying and mind since he's been gone.
We really play ourselves. We're not like soap opera people doing a role. So people are real interested in our personal lives. And for some reason, back in those days, the fan magazines jumped on it too. The Lennon sisters were big fan magazine stars. And then when I married Myron Florin's daughter, Christy, we were on all these magazine covers.
In our family, let's see, Peggy married Dick Cathcart, who was a trumpet player, Dixie trumpet player on the show. Kathy married Malin Clark, who played Dixie clarinet. And I married the stage manager on the show, Lee Bernhardi. So.
And Barbara married Greg from the Blenders, which was a singing group on the show. And Barbara got married
Christy.
Yes.
Mary Lou Metzger married Richard Maloof, the bass player. Larry Welk Jr. married Tanya, one of our singers. And Lawrence used to always say, my beautiful daughter-in-law will now sing you a song. Yeah, he was very proud. So it was one big happy family in more ways than one.
So many nights
nights I'd sit by my window waiting for someone to sing me a song. So many dreams I've kept deep inside me, alone in the dark, but now you've come along and you light up my life.
Guy and I were married for 15 years. We were on the show for 13 years together. And, you know, we just kind of grew in different directions.
It was really difficult when Ron and I split up. We were still working together, and fortunately, it was at the end of the TV series run, so a lot of the media people lost interest in us.
Adrift on the water.
It was very difficult for me. I was very young, and I got my feelings hurt, and I just had to leave. A chance
to say. Our daughter Julia was the worst part, and then the fans, the Lawrence Welk fans, they were just crushed. I mean, the ones that knew about it. You know, there's still a lot of people that still don't know it. And because we continue to work together, you know, there's that speculation, oh, what are they doing? They're going to get back together. Because, you know, they looked at us as like just the perfect couple. It was really sad for us, for the fans, too.
Our fans are the best. I know everybody says that, but they are lovely, forgiving people who have been through the same things. And I just so appreciate it.
You light up my life.
Life. Oh, that's what people say. You're riding high in April, shot down in May. But I know I'm gonna change that tune when I'm back on top in June. I said that's life, and funny as it seems, some folks get their kicks just stepping on dreams. But I won't let it get me down, 'cause this old world just keeps spinning around. I've been a puppet, a pauper, a pirate, a poet, a pawn, and a king. And I've been up, down, over, out, and I know one thing, that each time I find myself flat on my knees, I pick myself and get back in the race. That's life. Oh, and I can't deny it. Many times I thought of quitting, but this heart of mine wouldn't buy it. And if there's nothing shaking come this next July, I'm gonna roll myself up in a big ball and die my mind.
The clown with his pants falling down for the dance. That's a dream of romance on the scene where the villain is mean.
That's entertainment.
The lights and those fabulous sights for a guy who gets hit with a pie. He's a ham to his millions of fans.
That's entertainment.
It might be a fight like you see on the screen. A swain dead and slain for the love of a queen. when ends and ends meet. The gang may be waving the flag that began with a Mr. Cohan. Hip hooray, the American way. The world is a stage, the stage is a world of entertainment.
Yeah. Thank you so much, my friends, and a warm welcome to you all. It's our pleasure to be your host from Pacific Ocean Park and the Aragon Ballroom, where we have been playing for the past 9 years.
Well, when we first came to California, we were doing our show locally from the Aragon Ballroom, and we rehearsed at the ballroom, and we did the show from the ballroom, too.
The dressing rooms were just a small place in back, and draperies that were about ready to collapse. And we did the show right there on stage.
Would you like to swing on a star? Carry moonbeams home in a jar. And be there.
Saturdays we would go down like, 8:30, 9 o'clock in the morning. And it was live. The show was live then. But we would do it at 5 o'clock, and whether you were ready or not, 5 o'clock, that, you know, the lights went on and the cameras were running, and you did it.
The show never really changed through all those years that I was with him. The only thing that changed at all was when we had to start taping shows instead of doing them live, and he was against that. His philosophy was, if a person knows they can stop tape, they're not going to be on top of that number. And I know a lot of people in the show finally found out we were going to tape. They said, oh boy, this is a piece of cake now. Wrong. Lawrence said we're going to do that show just like it's live.
Up, up and away, my beautiful balloon.
We did something very interesting that a lot of people might not know. In those early years, well, really all the years that we were on the Welk Show, because technology wasn't great when we first started, they really had these big boom mics. And because we were four different heights and it was very hard to follow us around with this one boom, we would go in on Saturday mornings and we would pre-record everything we ever sang on the Welk Show. We would sing our song, and they didn't even have tape then. They would put it on an electrical transcription, which is where the vinyl peels off and all that. It was like a record. And at night, when the show was on, they would play the record and we would lip sync to it.
Lawrence decided that the taps weren't coming through clear enough, so he decided that the best way would be to pre-record the taps. Just like lip syncing, you come out and you tap sync it.
The way he moves is really something. Take it away, off the nothing.
What? I didn't have the liberty to go out and ad lib, because once that's set, you have to match it. And it was very difficult to do that, so it kept me very strict.
It took 3 days to put out one Lawrence Welk Show. It started on a Thursday, and we would go into the Annex recording studio and lay down on tape all of the numbers that were going to be in the show that week, so that Lawrence could hear what the show was going to be, and so that Jim Hobson would have a chance to prepare his camera angles for the actual show itself. The first thing Jack and I did together on the show was actually a number with Bobby and Sissy. And I thought, oh boy, I better be good on this one. And there was a spoon chorus. Well, I rehearsed so hard that by the time we finally came to taping, I was black and blue from my hip all the way to my knee. Then on Monday, we got together at the studio and set dancers and did choreography and so forth. And then on Tuesday, we'd come in at 9 o'clock in the morning, start a camera rehearsal. and would probably go through each number two or three times. By 5:15, we did a dress rehearsal for an audience, for a live audience. And then at 8 o'clock, we taped the show. It started right at 8 and ended right at 9. And that was it, to put out one show. It was 1 hour straight through, live on tape. The audience was always there. They were smiling. They were happy. It was fabulous. And, you know, Lawrence sometimes got tired. But the minute he stood before that audience, he was alive. The music was, it was just like, what did he call it? He said it was like a drug, but he never took drugs.
California!
Yeah.
California!
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 California! Here I come!
Yeah. Our audiences would write into the Welk office and ask for tickets. And for the bulk of the time I was on the show, they were sold out for about 18 months ahead of time. That's how popular the show was.
We lived our little drama. We kissed in a field of white, and stars fell on Alabama last night.
People were leaving the show. Some of them wanted to try it on their own, The Lennon sisters, you know, they'd grown up, had families of their own, and I think they wanted to try something a little different. So when this happened, Lawrence started hiring more singers.
Oh, the merry-go-round broke down.
In the late 1960s, Lawrence hired a lot of girl singers. It started in 1967 with Andrew Willis and Tanya Fallon, who later became Lawrence's daughter-in-law and became Tanya Welk. Then in 1968, Sandy and Sally came on the show when the Lennon sisters left. In 1969, Ralna English and Gail Farrell joined the show, and then I came along in 1970. So the Champagne Sorority sisters were in full swing.
Hope-de-do, hope-de-do.
Oh, it's got me higher than a cloud. Hand me down my soup and fish. I am gonna get my wish. Hope-de-do and it tonight.
It's almost 50 years that I've been with the show, so I don't remember as clearly as I should. But I started to count the people in each number and how many costumes. And it was, no show was less than 70 to 100 costumes.
And now, the champagne maestro himself, Lawrence Welk.
Don't you cats know this polka jazz is strictly from Squaresville? I can't stand that kind of music.
We did make a hippie costume for Lawrence. I had a wig for him, I had the peace sign for him, we had the small little glasses, and we had this wild vest. It was so cute.
Mr. Welk, what's happening here?
This isn't like you at all. Have you flipped your bippy?
No, huh?
Whatever happened to the music that went doodly 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 doot? We just don't like you like this.
You don't?
And we're protesting.
What?
We're protesting.
You're protesting? Mm-hmm. Well, what do you think you're gonna do?
Let's see.
Lawrence was considered corny to the critics, only. And I got news for you. This show, it went with the times. If a song was a good song for us and it was high on the top 100 in Billboard, we'd play it. We'd do it.
If anybody watched the Lawrence Welk Show, it seemed like that he tried to show off all types of music. I remember watching Lynn Anderson when I watched the show every Saturday night with my mother.
All the wheat fields and the clotheslines and the junkyards and the highways come between us. And some other man is crying to his daddy cause he turned and I was gone.
I felt like that she opened the doors for country music as far as being on a sophisticated show like that, you know, the Lawrence Welk Show, champagne music, you know. But I think Lawrence, he appreciated all types of music. Of course, he had his favorite, but he tried to have different types to please everybody.
I dipped my cup of soup back from the gurgling, crackling cauldron in some train yard. My beard a roughening coal pile and a dirty hat pulled low across my face. And two cupped hands round a tin can, I pretend to hold you to my breast and find that you're moving from the back roads by the rivers of my memory, ever smiling, ever gentle on my mind. Ever smiling, ever gentle on my mind.
Clay was one of my all-time favorite singers. I think he has one of the most beautiful male voices that I've ever heard. It's like cream. It's like chocolate cream. He's just velvet. He's smooth.
Bob Rawson came on the show and played all the most serious piano. I never heard such great technique in my life. He played with his technique. Just every note was there. I never heard a clinker.
At the time the show was canceled by ABC, I was working for Dot Records and had a separate career going, so I wasn't around that much. But I do know that my dad heard about it while he was on the golf course and that he got it from a reporter. He never heard it directly from ABC.
Was rushed to an office. A shrill phone rang, and it was a reporter from UPI. Called him and said, "Well, Lawrence, what do you think of your show being canceled?" And he said, "Well, of course, I'm very disappointed. Not so much for myself, but for my musical family. I've got to think of something to do for them."
How you gonna keep them down on the farm after they've seen Harry?
we heard about it, we were at the studio recording the show. And of course, there was a deathly pall over the whole group. And I was sitting there thinking, I can't retire. I'm too young to retire.
When we heard that the show was canceled, it was like our life was taken from us. It really, I cried. We all cried. It was a big blow to us because the show was very, very popular.
It was the opinion of the executives and ABC, the young executives, that they wanted a younger audience, and that Lawrence didn't fit the bill there. Lawrence Welk had built that network.
Geritol, Sominex, all of those products were products that sponsored the Lawrence Welk Show when it was on ABC. And after the show was canceled, it was really the reason that we could go right into syndication, because Matty Rosenhaus called my dad and said, if you continue to produce the show, we'll sponsor it.
I wanna be happy, but I won't be happy.
Don Featherston, who was a big producer out there, had a lot to do with the Welk Show, sent out a telegram to every TV station in the United States.
The other stroke of luck that happened, and it was pure luck, is the year the show was canceled is the same year that the Federal Communications Commission gave back an hour of network programming to all of the local stations. And the government said, you can no longer air network shows during this hour. Nobody was producing syndicated shows. So my dad had the opportunity to be able to go directly to those stations and sell them his one-hour show. And there was a real need for that at that time.
He got over 200 stations that said, we want it. We kept right on going. It never stopped.
He would read something or hear something or see something, and he would come to me and say, I've got something for you. He did that dozens of times.
Pretty, it sure does. On the outskirts of our town lived a gal named Sadie Brown, and they say she's making money by the peck. For this simple country maid, she landed on the hit parade in a manner that we never did expect. They call her Sage Mercedes, the famous bearded lady. Her whiskers brought her riches and renown. They're the pride of the museum, and it costs two bits to see them. And the family's getting rich on Sadie Brown.
It had a jillion words to it.
She's got a baby daughter. She's got a mustache like an otter. She's the image of her mother, Sadie Brown.
Sadie Brown.
I watched the reruns at home on Saturday, and some of the things that Lawrence has done there is just, it's just funny to me.
There's sunny little funny little melody that was started by a native down in Waikiki. He would gather a crowd down beside the sea and they'd play his gay Hawaiian chant. Soon the other little native started singing it and the hula hula maiden started swinging it like a tropical storm. That's the way
he had a sense of humor and you could have fun with Lawrence.
Away, 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 away.
They'd like to see Lawrence Welk do things that were cute and funny because Lawrence Welk was so stiff when he announced everything and he looked like real stiff. But then he was a fun guy.
Great, but that hairdo must go. But don't worry, folks, her hair grows real fast.
The Lawrence Welk Show itself changed quite a bit at the time I was on it, that 12 years. I don't think Lawrence Welk changed that much. I mean, you know, we all get a little more mellow, but I mean, he was still pretty straight. But the big change, of course, was that he kept hiring new people, but nobody left. So we had a lot of cast.
Henry was greatly respected as a musician, and he took a lot of pride in his work. But he was a showman above everything. Great entertainer, and she has a wonderful voice, but she makes these costumes from scratch herself, and each costume is more beautiful than the other.
Anna Connie, she took us under her wing, because see, we lived with my mother, so we'd never been out on our own, and we never had an apartment or anything like that. She let me know that there was an apartment beside her that was available, and we just became big pals. Back then, we went to Escondido on the weekends and worked at the Welk restaurant, you know, singing and everything.
Staying up an old town, well, it takes me to my hometown. Years have brought my heart down, but my soul was born to fly. My grandpa taught the ride. He taught the love of Jesus. All the earth will someday be a kingdom paradise. He's singing, I'll fly.
When we first moved to California, he says, I'm going to be your mother and father while you're here.
Let my childhood overtake me back to Tennessee.
When I first flew out to California, Lawrence Welk wanted me to meet his production staff, and Tom was there.
On a clear day, rise and look around you.
He had that charisma and that charm, and you know, everybody was saying, oh, I wish my daughter could find somebody like that to marry, you know, and he just took off fantastically because he had that charisma and the look and the big baritone voice.
Astound you that the glow of your being outshines every star you feel part of. Every mountain, sea, and shore you can hear from far.
Johnny Zale was real close to Tom Netherton, and Tom Netherton was his best man, and I was one of the bridesmaids. And Tom told him about being a Christian and everything, and he came to know the Lord. And I think that when he did that, he changed a lot, because I think he was a little wild when he first joined the Welk Show. That was before my time, but I've heard some stories. But it seemed like when he became a Christian, he changed. There were so many people on the show, and it was hard to get everybody on in an hour. That was one thing about Lawrence. Nobody ever was gone.
Well, I enjoyed working with Jack and Arthur. Jack was such a creative guy, you know. In fact, we did a lot of two-man horses and two-man cows and would flip a coin and whoever lost got to be the back.
I might tell you, the bull was played by Bobby Burgess and Jack Emmel in that order from north to south.
Because it's one of those songs that can make you recall a ride in the springtime, a walk in the fall.
Well, the Aldridge sisters, Sheila was the one that cut up all the time, and Sherry was the more grim and proper one, you know. And when they joined the show, I thought they had a nice sound, and then Lawrence Welk put the Otwells and the Aldridges together.
The reason is simple, the memory belongs to one of those wonderful stars.
Roger and David are down-to-earth boys, and they just had a beautiful family blend. I thought they were little dolls, and they have one brain.
One of the songs that you hear for a while and come into fashion and go out of style. It's one of the songs that you think you forgot, but it's one of the songs you cannot.
They just kept hiring him until he got too many for the bus. Then he had to quit.
Of course, I had three different dancing partners on the Welk Show. Each of my partners was completely different. Barbara had that wholesome, all-American girl look, and she was so much fun, and I think the audience really enjoyed her warmth and her nice personality and a fine dancer. Sissy, she was very athletic, and she did lifts, and she was out there, and the blonde and all. And then Elaine, with her long legs, was athletic also, but in a different sort of way. So all three were completely different. So each time I changed partners, I grew because they would come in with new ideas, you know, and I'd show them my things, and then we'd compromise and create new dance routines. Lawrence never wanted to have you stop because he was raised on live TV. And I can only think that I stopped twice in all those 21 years. And it was both with Sissy. One time we were doing an outer space dance, and the other time was tinickling, the bamboo dance where you dance in and out of the poles. And one time, somehow she got her ankle caught, and you know, it really hurt. She started crying, and then they stopped.
If someone dropped dead, you just shoot high, drag them off, and keep the show keep the show going. It wasn't quite that bad, but it was but pretty much. But I think he was right in that. Keep the thing going, and people enjoyed to see some of those things. They're in on it then. So it was fun.
You people have seen television history being made. Frankenstein split his pants. Woo!
The decision to end the Lawrence Welk Show in 1982 was largely driven by my father. He was 79 years old. While he was in good health, he was beginning to lose some of his, things were getting hard for him to remember. And I think he recognized that in himself and he didn't want to be embarrassed. So I think he felt, we've done this for 27 years, this is the time I should give it up.
When we heard that the syndicated show was not going to continue, everyone sort of held their breath and thought, what now?
Well, it was not a happy day for sure, because I'd been sitting in that chair for 31 years. We did 1,065 shows. I only missed about four or five. And I said, what am I going to do? I don't know anything but music.
We were all there. My sisters were there. My mother was there. My wife was there. Everybody was there. Tons of emotion pouring out of everybody. There was happiness, there was tears, sadness.
Everybody came back for that day and, you know, to watch the show. And you know, you just sit there and you'd look around the set and you'd look at the crew especially. You know, I mean, most of us, the people on the show, we knew we were gonna continue to see each other, but a lot of that crew that had worked with us for all those years, we, you know, weren't gonna see them. And, It was a bittersweet day that day.
Everyone, I think, in the cast and the orchestra and whatnot were a little down, but you know, we were all so grateful that the show had such a tremendous run over the years.
We did. There's no business like show business as a closer. And it makes my hair stand on end just to think of it.
The day we taped the last show, it was so emotional, because no one knew what the future would bring. And we were crying and laughing. It was a very emotional day. And I remember at dress rehearsal, I thought, we need to laugh. This is just getting too heavy. And I went to our drummer, Paul Humphrey, and asked him if I could borrow two of his cymbals. And I strapped them to my knees. And our last number was There's No Business Like Show Business. And at the very last, I lifted my skirt and clanged my knees together. And Lawrence couldn't see over into that area as to what we were doing. He just saw me lift my skirt.
There's no people like show people. They smile when they are low.
My father, after the last show, was almost somewhat in shock. After all this time and what he'd done all his life, it was over. So I think there was all sorts of emotions in him.
Hey!
after the show went off the air, my dad lived another 10 years. He still loved being around people. He would go down to the resort in Escondido, and he kept an accordion down there, and he would walk through serenading the patrons.
What is it that we're living for? Applause, applause. Nothing I know.
In 1986, Lawrence Welk gave his last taped interview, and it was for our very first public television special called Lawrence Welk Television's Music Man.
Hear it starting.
He lived for 6 years after that, and I'm so glad because he got to see his show, his baby, have a home on public television.
You've had a taste of the sound that says love.
I wish Lawrence Welk was still around today. Oh, I would be in awe of him even more. I would let him know. I didn't let him know. See, that's the thing. You don't let him know. You let him hope he hears me now. You know, just hope he's listening right now.
Give me 5 minutes more. Only 5 minutes more. Let me stay. Let me stay in your arms. Here am I. Only 5 minutes more, only 5 minutes more of your charms. All week long I dreamed about our Saturday date.
Don't you know that Sunday morning you can't sleep late?
Give me 5 minutes more, only 5 minutes more. Let me stay in your arms.
My good friends, a pleasant good evening and a warm welcome. Recently, I had the great pleasure of playing in the Walt Disney World Golf Tournament in Florida. Once again, I was tremendously impressed by all the wonderful things this late genius Walt Disney has done for family entertainment in America. This evening, we're devoting our entire show to a tribute to this great man, his movies, and his fabulous amusement centers, Walt Disney World and Disneyland. Let's start with a medley of songs from the delightful Mary Poppins.
In every job that must be done, there is an element of fun. You find the fun and snap the jobs again. And every task you undertake becomes a piece of cake. A lark, a spree, it's very clear to see that a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down. The medicine go down, just
Just a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down. In the most delightful way.
Kick your knees up, step in time. Kick your knees up, step in time. Never need a reason, never need a rhyme. Kick your knees up, step in time. Kick your knees up, step in time. Kick your knees up, step in time. Never need a reason, never need a rhyme. Kick your knees up, step in time.
Doesn't that make you feel a little better?
I was a senior in high school, and I was asked to do this number with Aladdin where I was to play a little French schoolgirl, schoolgirl, and he was my French professor. And I wore a really cute outfit, I remember. And Laddie claimed that he could speak,
50,000
different languages or something. So Laddie taught me this song called The French Lesson. And to this day, I know every single word to it in French. I don't know any French but that. And there was one really long segment that goes like this. Garçon et fille, cheveux de hair, les yeux sont bleus, la bouche la main. Je et vous, tu chattes fermé, tu ouvres ouvrir la porte du bois, rouge blanc et noir, le papier, le cahier, le crayon, la chaise, la plume, le livre. See? That's what he taught me. Don't know what it means.
Le livre, la plume, la chaise.
No, mon petit, ce n'est pas correct. That is not correct way. Listen, I will show you, hein? The book, le livre.
Le livre, the book.
The pen, la plume.
La plume, the pen.
La chaise.
Le chaise.
Le crayon.
Le crayon.
Le cahier.
Le cahier.
Le papier.
Le papier.
Noir, rouge et blanc. A black, red and white.
Rouge, blanc et noir.
Ah, you're very bright. Now, let's go back, hein? You have to get them right.
Rouge, blanc et noir, le papier, le cahier, le crayon, la chaise, la plume, le livre, et rouge, la chaise, et noir.
That's wonderful.
You call this work? Why, it's more like play. In no time, Vlad, you parle français.
Have you had enough?
No, I'm just starting.
All right, you asked for it. The door, la porte.
La porte, the door.
Of wood, de bois.
De bois, of wood.
To open, ouvrir.
Ouvrir, to open.
To shut, fermer.
Fermer, to shut.
The pronouns that you need are je and vous. Je means I, and vous means you. Now, do them all.
Just watch me go right through. Je et vous, tu chattes fermé, tu open ouvrir la porte, tu bois rouge, blanc et noir, le papier, le cahier, le crayon, la chaise, la plume, le livre. J'ouvre la porte, je ferme la porte.
C'est merveilleux.
My thirst for learning, you can't quench. Come fill me up to here with French.
More?
More.
Oh, you'll explode.
Well, who cares?
The hand, la main.
La main, the hand.
The mouth, la bouche.
La bouche, the mouth.
Les yeux sont bleus. Ah, they really are blue. The hair, les cheveux.
The hair, les cheveux.
The words for boy and girl, garçon et fille.
Garçon et fille are he and she.
Now, from the top, if you want a French degree.
Garçon, et puis les cheveux, the hair, les yeux sont bleus, la bouche, la main. Je et vous, tu chattes, fermez, tu open, ouvrez la porte du bois rouge. Blanc et noir, la papille, les cahiers, les crayons, la chaise, la plume, la livre.
Mademoiselle.
Monsieur.
Les yeux sont bleus.
Oh, you're crazy.
Won't you come and join me in a dance? You could be a resident of France.
Gail Farrell met her husband, Ron Anderson, in an acting class. And she also did so much studio singing, she knew Michael Redman. So they got together and formed a trio and became Gail, Ron, and Michael.
In the mood, that's what she told me, in the mood. And when she told me in the mood, my heart was skipping. It didn't take me long to say I'm in the mood. Who's the living dolly with the beautiful eyes? What a pair of lips I'd like to try and precise. I'll just tell her, baby, won't you swing it with me? Hope she tells me, baby, what a wing it would be. So I said politely, darling, may I intrude? She said,
don't keep me waiting when I'm in the mood.
First I held her lightly and we started to dance. Then I held it tightly, but a dreamy romance. And I said, hey baby, it's a quarter to three. There's a mess of moonlight, won't you share it with me? Well, she answered,
mister, don't you know that it's rude to keep my lips a-waiting when they're in the mood.
In the mood, they're all a-kissing. In the mood, they're crazy loving. In the mood, what I was missing, it didn't take me long to say I'm in the mood now. Do-ba-do-ba-do-ba.
One of the Lennon sisters would become pregnant, we still needed four costumes alike. So whoever was pregnant at that time, Janet or Peggy or Dee Dee, we would get material that's like t-shirt material, stretch material, open up the backs, and put a wide piece down the back of the dress. You'd never see their backs. So it allowed the dress to expand to where we needed it for it to expand. Then we had Joanne Castle, and it was an Easter show, and they wanted her at the piano. So we got together, I got together with the art director, Chuck Coons, a fabulous art director, by the way, wonderful art director. And I said, what can we do to hide Joanne and still make it Easter?
Thank you. We can always count on Joanne to add a spark to the show. She can really play the piano.
I always remember Guy Lombardo, and there were several other bands that had twin pianos. And we came up with this idea. We were talking. Frank Scott, who is a great player, and Larry Hooper is a great player, and Jerry Burke. He was the organist with the Lawrence Welk Show at the very beginning, but he started in 1934, came out to California, but he played organ, but he could play piano. So the four of us worked up a number, and I felt really great because I was the lady of the group, and the four of us worked up this number, and I think it came off looking good. I really do, and we should have done more of those. I really think so. When I met Jim, I just fell in love with him. He was down to earth, and we did a lot of duets together, cut it up, and had a lot of fun, you know. And there toward, I think, the 80s, 80, 81, 82, you know, he let us do a bunch of duets together, me and Jim Turner. So I like Jim. He's a great guy.
Don't let the loneliness get to you while I'm so far away from home. All my love will ride with you down every crooked road. It's with you every minute you're alone.
Don't forget there's someone here who wants you. Just remember when you need someone, you've got a lonely woman here who really misses you. Jim Bob's waiting.
Ava's waiting. Waiting at the end of your run.
The road that takes you from my arms will bring you back to me. I count the days until the job is done. I've learned to live with the loneliness I share. Trucker's life, Jim Bob's waiting.
Ava's waiting.
Waiting at the end of your run. The road that takes you from my arms will bring you back to me. I count the days until the job is done. I've learned to live with the loneliness I share. A trucker's life, Jim Bob's waiting.
Ava's waiting.
Waiting at the end of your run. I've learned to live with the loneliness I share. A trucker's life, Jim Bob's waiting.
Ava's waiting.
Waiting at the end of your road.
live.
I love the Halloween shows in particular because there was so much production. We had haunted houses and laboratories and witches on brooms, and it was so much fun for everyone because so often people would just get to sing in front of the band, and this was a chance to just go all out.
Singer and also accordion player again. I wonder if you could teach me a little time step, please.
I'd love to.
Let me see it. Start me out on it, right on television here.
Now you try it.
Go away. One. One and two and a. Why don't you teach me a hard one now? Once more. I think I'll practice that first time.
I think if he wanted to be a tap dancer, he could have been one, because he loved dancing, and as we all know, he loved dancing with the ladies, and he was a tremendous dancer.
And now our boss, Lawrence Welk, would like to dance to the music of one of his favorite songs, played by one of his favorite orchestras and with one of his favorite dancing partners, the song Fascination.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alice, for that very nice dance.
I think that Lawrence Welk, in his heart, would loved America. I mean, there was no phony business, nothing that wasn't real about his love for this country. He was a patriot. And I mean, he took every opportunity to tell people, you know, how lucky they were to live in this country. And like a lot of the title of his books and a lot of the content of his books was, you know, and this, you can be what you want to be in this country. So, and I'm a real patriotic guy too, so he and I really had that bond.
In the early days of this century, a songwriter came along who proudly proclaimed himself a Yankee Doodle Dandy. He became one of our most famous composers of patriotic songs. We'd like to give you a medley of songs by the great George M. Cohan.
Should old acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag.
For it is Mary, Mary, plain as any name can be, but with propriety, society will say Marie. But it was Mary, Mary, long before the fashions came. And there is something there that sounds so fair. It's a grand old name.
I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy, a Yankee Doodle do or die, a real live nephew of my Uncle Sam, born on the 4th of July. I've got a Yankee Doodle sweetheart, she's my Yankee Doodle joy. Yankee Doodle came to London just to ride the ponies. I am a Yankee Doodle boy.
Give my regards to Broadway. Remember me to Herald Square. Tell all the gang at 42nd Street that I will soon be there. Whisper of how I'm yearning to mingle with the old time throng. Give my regards to old Broadway and say that I will.
I'm rather proud of the man being honored this evening. I'm Lawrence Welk's second daughter, Donna. Many people have played a part in my father's career and have had an influence on his life, but I'm sure the one person who has had the greatest influence, the one who has helped him over all the rough spots and inspired him the most, has been my mother. During the lean years, she made us a home in hotels and motels across the country while the band played one-nighters and short engagements. Mom and Dad recently celebrated their 40th wedding anniversary. Yes, I'm really very proud of them.
Oh, how we danced on the night we were wed. We vowed our true love, though a word
lovely wife, Fern, in one of her very rare television appearances. Of course, I may be in trouble now. She may want to be in show business now that she has a taste of it.
In 1971, Lawrence released his autobiography. Wonderful, wonderful. And we did an entire show about it. And what was so nice was he invited his family down to the taping. And on the show, he danced with Mrs. Welk. And at the end of the dance, he kissed her. And I think that's probably the only kiss on camera, and it was so sweet.
There was another musical instrument in the Welk household, a small pump organ that Grandfather Welk had saved his pennies to buy for the family. My dad got an early start in music on that instrument when he was just 4 years of age. His favorites were the old German folk songs.
Thank you, Myron. And by the golly, it's been many, many years since I played that organ.
I'd stand over at the side and watch Lawrence when the show's on. When the band played, that's when you'd see him light up.
Boys, the woodchopper's ball. One, two.
Oh, Our boss is having a ball tonight.